We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
Welcome to LA Progressive Live, where we delve deep into issues of progressive politics and social justice. This is your host, Sharon Kyle, in studio with my husband and co-host, Dick Price.
How you doing, sugar?
I'm doing fine. How are you today, babe?
I'm really looking forward to this show. I like our show every week, but this one in particular, we've made friends with an activist from here in Los Angeles who has emerged as not only a spokesman on issues of civilian oversight, beating of prisoners in the LA County jails, but has emerged as a national and indeed international spokesperson on these issues, Patrisse Cullors, and with that, in she walks.
Right. So we met Patrisse a few years ago.
Right.
And so she's going to be in studio with us in about 5 minutes. We're going to sit down and start our interview with Patrisse.
Right.
And before we begin to talk about Patrisse, let's set the stage a little bit about today's show. So tomorrow is April the 14th, 2015, and there is a national action that's going down tomorrow across the nation at various cities. The action has been called by Cornel West and Carl Dix. And Cornel West and Carl Dix insist, as do many others, that the police are still killing unarmed people and that this must stop. The action is called hashtag, let me get this straight now, hashtag shut down A14. And hashtag shut down A14 is calling for people across the nation to stop business as usual. We have a few flyers that are banners that are going up to talk to where you would go to find out about this action. But there are actions in Los Angeles and New York and quite a few other major metropolitan communities across the nation.
Yeah, so last week we had, I thought, a really good show with somebody who is kind of new to Black Lives Matter but is definitely involved in these issues, Ishtime Robinson, who had lost two children to police violence under unusual or suspicious circumstances. You know, the thing I wanted to say, and since we talked to Ishtime, there's been several more murders of young black men and not so young black men by police. In one case, sort of a pretend 73-year-old kind of policeman who got to wear a gun and a badge because he gave money to a police force. You know, a few weeks ago we interviewed a journalist, Ellen Snortland, who writes for the Pasadena Weekly, and that was about women's issues and women's self-defense. And I had asked, you know, what is it in recent years that you hear so much about rape on campus? You know, is something different about young people than when I was in college a million years ago? I never really heard much about rape on campus. And she practically leapt out of her seat and said, oh no, rapes are not any more prevalent now than they were then. And she said she herself had been raped as a college student long ago. And what is different is two things. One is women, young women, women in general, feel more empowered to step forward and say and claim what's gone on. And second, social media makes it so that the word gets out quickly. Years ago, if somebody were raped on a college campus, they'd probably have to go to some counselor, probably a man, a police officer, probably a man, the newspaper reporter, probably a man, and the story would never go anywhere, and they would, you know, the time was that they would feel ashamed to even own up to it. And I wonder if that's what's going on here with the murder of young black men in particular. You know, it seems like every week you hear about it over and over and over and over again, whereas you didn't years ago. But maybe it's just that particularly the white community is hearing about it now in a way the black community always knew about that.
Yeah, I think that that probably is right. I think the social media has put a focus on it that it would not have had otherwise, because what we're talking about here is the establishment newspapers. They tend to not report on what's happening in the black community in the same way that they would report what's going on in the white community. Like, frequently, I mean, I've talked about Emmett Till and we've talked about Trayvon Martin. In both of those cases, both of those stories were picked up by alternative media. In the case of Emmett Till back in, I guess it was 1955, in that case, it was Jet Magazine.
Right.
Where Mamie Till, Emmett Till's mother, made the decision to have that horrible photograph put out for publication.
Right.
Had that alternative news source not existed, that story would never have made the national headlines. So what's happening today, as what happened yesterday or years ago, is that because people are taking social media and they're spreading these stories on their own, the traditional media is being forced to also address it, but of course not to the level that we would expect. But it is a national story, and we've got to keep this in the forefront of people's minds because we need to see a change. And that's what hashtag shutdown A14 is all about.
Right. And so media is one component of it. But obviously, we're talking to perhaps the leading proponent of getting the word out by activities in the streets and forums and keeping the news in front of people and not letting these murders just go idly by, because as you say, you know, the mainstream media may be forced to report on things more so now than they were, but there's a countervailing force that wants to say, oh no, it's really the fault of the victims. That
right.
They were acting wrong, they did something wrong, and so the police officer is excused.
Well, not only that, I think it's really important to keep the frequency of this out there in the public, because it does another thing. If you keep this in the shadows, it further emboldens these lawless police officers and other law enforcement and other state actors. It emboldens them, and it gives them this sense that they can just kind of do whatever the hell they want to.
Right.
So I encourage everyone, LA Progressive is taking a position on this. We will continue to report this story until we see change. And we're going to be taking a break, but before we take the break, I just want to mention that there are lots of other efforts that require involvement to make a change in this country, and one of them is involvement in law. Now, there is a law school, People's College of Law, that
I've heard of that school.
Yeah, well, I happen to be a professor there.
Right.
That's where I got my law degree, and that's where I teach. People's College of Law in Los Angeles, that's peoplescollegeoflaw.edu, trains...
Who made that website?
That website, well, I guess I helped them out a little bit. Okay, so People's College of Law trains people who are interested in public interest law. We're not talking about people who are interested in making buku bucks supporting corporations. We're talking about people, activists, progressives, who want to have a stronger, more effective movements. And
right.
Working through the law is one of the ways to do
right.
that.
Right, and among the famous people that have gone through there has been Gil Cedillo, the city councilman, the
Maria Elena DeRosa,
the famous labor leader, and Antonio Villaraigosa, and Sharon Kyle.
That's right.
And I know you said to me and to others that you would desperately like to see more people like you, more black and brown people show up to that college to be empowered, to be, and the idea of the school is to train activists, not corporate lawyers.
That's correct. Okay, so we're going to be taking a little bit of a break, and when we return, we will be interviewing our guest, Patrisse Cullors, who is one of the co-founders of Black Lives Matter. This is Sharon Kyle and Dick Price of LA Progressive Live, streaming to you live from LATalkLive.com. We'll be back in a bit. Stick around.
We're already late. We've been looking for a song to sing. Search for a melody. Search for someone to lead. We've been looking for the world to change. If you feel the same, then go on and say.
Welcome back to LA Progressive Live. This is your host, Sharon Kyle, in studio with my co-host and husband, Dick Price. And just before we broke, we talked about our guest. Dick, why don't you introduce who we have in studio with us?
So several years ago, we got to know Patrisse Cullors, who seems to be the leader or co-leader or co-founder of everything. Dignity and Power Now,
yes.
Black Lives Matter, yep. Which has now become a nationwide or even international organization. Mm-hmm. Organization that is about violence in the jail system. I forgot the name of that. So you have emerged, and you were named in Time magazine as one of the leading civil rights leaders of our time. Mm-hmm. A remarkable feat for quite a young woman. Maybe you could start. So, what in your background, what in your life, has driven you to be such a diehard activist on these issues?
Well, it's really good to be on the show, and it's good to see the both of you. Well, I think the biggest reason why I've stepped into this role as fighting specifically law enforcement violence, both right. in the streets and in the jails, has much to do with my own story. And right. I think many of us, especially black folks who grew up in this country, have faced time and time again law enforcement violence. Be it verbal abuse, be it physical abuse, or really a lot of us have faced, you know, law enforcement murdering our loved ones.
Right.
And so my story starts with growing up in Van Nuys, California, which is a little suburb, a barrio outside of the inner city of L.A. It's still part of L.A. City, everybody. San Fernando Valley is still part of L.A. City. And in that suburb, the police patrolled my neighborhood on a daily basis, harassed my siblings on a daily basis. And I remember at the age of 9, the police coming in and raiding my home and looking for my uncle at the time. And I always say that I grew up during the war on drugs and the war on gangs.
Right.
And the impact of the war on drugs, literally it was a war on the black community. And I was one of its victims, and I say now survivors. So that's what brings me to being so earnest about fighting for black lives in particular, and really calling for law enforcement to be held accountable for its actions.
So when we met you, I don't really remember that, maybe 4 or 5 years ago yeah. now, you were working to end sheriff violence mm-hmm. in jails. And at the time, Lee Baca was mm-hmm. the sheriff for Los Angeles County. Since then, Baca has resigned, and he sort of resigned in the shadow of corruption and sheriff abuse. And so now we have a new sheriff, Jim McDonald, and we have an inspector general, Max Huntsman. So can you talk to us a little bit about, since the end sheriff violence, Lee Baca's resignation, the things that you and your organization have been doing, and now we have a new sheriff in town, and what does that mean?
So to give a little bit of history, in 2011, at the end of 2011, I read the ACLU's 86-page complaint against the Sheriff's Department, which is basically the impetus for the Coalition to End Sheriff Violence in LA Jails, which is a 20-plus organization coalition made up of orgs across Los Angeles County that has had one goal in particular, which was to push for the county to have independent, permanent civilian oversight of the Sheriff's Department. As of December of last year, we won that. Woohoo! Uh-huh. we have to claim our victories. And that has everything to do with the relentless work of the coalition and its allies. We, in the first year and a half, hosted 3 town halls across the county, which were well attended. We were able to get the ear of Supervisor Mark Ridley Thomas, who became a champion of civilian oversight of the Sheriff's Department. We pushed for Gloria Molina, who at first was not a champion, the former supervisor, and then eventually became a champion of civilian oversight. And then we were never able to successfully get former supervisor Xavier Slavsky to enact civilian oversight. But I believe our tireless sort of promotion.
Keep talking.
I was like, that's my voice. We were never able to get Supervisor Zebir Slosky to say yes, but the moment Supervisor Sheila Kuehl came in, she became our third vote. And so we are now in negotiations with a commission that was created to develop recommendations for this body. And I think this is important. Grassroots organizations across the country for decades have been fighting for things like civilian oversight, mm-hmm. to oversee corrupt police departments or sheriff's departments. And to have one here in Los Angeles for the largest jailer in the world is a pretty massive feat. And I think, you know, we're calling on Sheriff McDonald to really stand in solidarity and stand with the people who've been most directly impacted by the department he now runs, as well as Max Huntsman, who is the new Inspector General. We've had good interactions with Max Huntsman, but what I will say about the Inspector General's office that is difficult to swallow is that many of the people that he continues to hire don't reflect the actual people who've been impacted by law enforcement violence. And so we've really had, you know, transparent conversations with the office to look at diversity in his office, to look at the ways in which his office needs to gain the trust of the community as well.
Okay, so you're talking about Max Huntsman's office.
Yep, the Inspector General's office.
Do you know the size of his office and what percentage of the people who work there are people of color or people who have been directly impacted?
So eventually Max Huntsman's office, who is the Inspector General of the Sheriff's Department, will have about 40 employees. Right now it's at about 22. And I think he has about one or two people of color on his staff. A lot of them are coming from the district attorney's office. There's some former law enforcement. And he's heard the sort of call for there to be more people who've been directly impacted. And so I've spoken with some of his staff in which they're now looking at hiring more folks of color and looking at people who've actually had impact around law enforcement violence.
Right. So the Board of Supervisors set up a committee to look at the civilian oversight, and Sharon and I attended one of the meetings with a lot of your colleagues, and there's been a number of those meetings. And it was stark that there was a five or six older men.
And seven men.
Seven men, six of them white, all of them very well dressed.
And we have an image. We have an image that we took from your, it's the name of the image is Working Group Action.
So
that image will come
all of them well dressed and rather staid and very conservative. And then in the audience was Los Angeles.
Right.
I mean, it looked a lot more like Los Angeles, a lot younger,
right.
Much more diverse, lots more tattoos.
Right.
But more like the people who really are impacted by violence. And I glanced at one article by Jim McConnell was saying that, you know, he really hopes that we have a bunch of upright citizens on this eventual civilian oversight board.
So how
are you feeling about what the way this is going to play out?
As an organizer, I feel like we always have to be hopeful but sober. I think that, you know, we're calling for this civilian oversight body to have no law enforcement. I'm not sure that that's going to shore up because the County Board of Supervisors each will be able to pick their appointee. We are calling for four of those, of the nine board members, so we're calling for a nine-member board, four of those members to be appointed by the community, in which I think we will be able to get at least two of those people appointed by the community. We are calling for the commission to have independent legal counsel, so it's not reliant on county counsel. That can often be
co-opted,
right. Yes, and worried about a lawsuit,
right.
And so won't really stand for the community. We want this board to actually oversee the Office of Inspector General's work, Max Huntsman's work, because we think that the Civilian Oversight Board will have its ear to the community, so it should be able to steer the Inspector General's office in the direction that the community wants to. And I think as we call for this over and over again, we are seeing the commission, some commission members who are clearly not interested in a civilian oversight body, the working group. It's not a commission. It's called a working group. So
right.
Some working group members who are not interested in a civilian oversight body, and I would say that's probably ALADS, the Sheriff's Association. But then there's people like Hernan Vera, who is supervisor Hilda Solis's appointee, and he's very interested in getting a subpoena power, which is our final non-negotiable. We want subpoena power so that the officers or actual documents are able to be subpoenaed when the Inspector General needs to do any sort of investigations.
So there's a lot of talk about there's a federal investigation into the L.A. County jail system, an indictment or a ruling that things have to change. And McConnell campaigned a lot on treating people with mental problems and alcohol and drug problems separately or differently or outside of the jail. At least some of those recommendations that you helped put together recommends about that. Do you think that there's movement on that as well?
Well, I think, you know, the District Attorney Jackie Lacey is working on this, on how to reform the ways in which the mentally ill population in L.A. County is treated by law enforcement.
Right.
And we think that her reforms are headed in the right direction.
Right.
Sheriff McDonald has said good things. He has been clear, at least when we asked him to sit and debate with other candidates as sheriff, he was clear that he didn't want to see the mentally ill population inside county jails. But I think only time will tell. And we are going to continue to push back against the proposed $3.5 billion jail that this county is trying to build right now.
So there is an organization called the National Association for Civilian Oversight of Law Enforcement. The acronym is NACOLE, NACOLE.org. I don't know, you know, what you know about that organization. We've had a speaker come out to our community to speak at an ACLU forum,
right,
who was a representative from NACOLE. What has been your experience? Since you're nodding your head,
yeah.
I'm affirming, I guess, that yes, you are aware of them.
Yes, we received the contribution to Oversight Award by them last year.
Wonderful.
The coalition did. And was it Brian Buckner who was
yes,
on your show?
Yes, that's right. That's right.
Brian is great. He's been a great resource to the coalition. He was one of the first people that I ever spoke to about civilian oversight and its pros and cons. And he's been in meetings with myself and Supervisor Mercury Thomas discussing the ways in which civilian oversight could look here in L.A. County. So I applaud NACOLE. They've done great work to really push for clear standards for civilian oversight. And they've done great work here in L.A. They've also worked with folks in Pasadena around
Kendrick McDade.
Exactly, mm-hmm. In the Pasadena Police Department and the issues with them. So I think NACOLE is a great resource.
Great. So one of the things that we try to do here is, you know, we interview people, and also, you know, we have our sister organization, which is the LA Progressive, which is an online social justice magazine. And we alert people to issues of social justice and social, better said, it would be social injustice that go on in our communities. But we also want people to understand that there are things that they can do. Regular civilian, regular people are so desperately needed. And people can go to NACOLE, NACOLE.org, to find out how they can participate,
yes,
in civilian oversight. Or they can go to People's College of Law. Or they can go to your website,
which is dignityempowernow.org.
Oh, and, yes. I have an image for Patrisse Cullors.
That's great.
.com,
you can find me all those places.
Right. So what kind, if someone were to contact you, what kinds of things could they do if they want to be engaged and help to support this effort?
Well, if you're here in Los Angeles County, you can come out to a working group meeting, which the next one is this Friday, actually, April 17th at 9:30 at the County Board of Supervisors meeting building. And folks can also call one of their working group members. If you go onto our Facebook page, which is Dignity and Power Now, you can easily find information for who your working group member is according to your district. And we are soon going to be putting out a petition for civilian oversight that I Am Color of Change is going to be sponsoring. So we'll have that petition out within the next couple days.
So I have this concern that's somewhat related to this. Mm-hmm. You know, with Prop 47 that reduced some felonies to misdemeanor, mm-hmm, status, that's going to result in low-level offenders being released much earlier, and then the call to have people with mental health problems and drug and alcohol problems treated somewhere outside of the jail. Well, all that's good if there are resources in the community, and yes. and some of this has come together pretty quickly. And I've in the past I spent many years working with alcoholics and addicts, and I just wonder if we're ready for it. I mean, the worst thing we could do is release people, or not charge them and not provide them the kind of services so they can succeed. Then, like as not, they're going to commit some other crime and end up back in the system, and then we'll be no place.
Agreed. And I think that that's why District Attorney Jackie Lacey's proposal is so important, and why we push for there to be alternatives to incarceration. I think we have to be ready. I think there's no excuse to continue to put people who suffer from severe mental illness inside our jails, who suffer from alcohol and drug abuse inside our drug addiction inside our jails. And I think that there is a different sort of impetus now in LA County, given that we're in a vibrant movement, for people to really stand up and fight for those who are most directly impacted.
Yeah, I think absolutely. I think you in particular and the people around you have really caught fire. I mean, for this moment at least, many people who care about these issues and some who don't, it's on their radar. Mm-hmm. So I desperately hope that progress can be made, because the way that these things work is, you know, Occupy was what we talked about a few years ago, and now we don't.
Right.
You know, so.
So before we begin our discussion about Black Lives Matter, we will take a break. But before we take the break, Patrisse, I was wondering if you could tell our listening audience a little bit about what happened with you and your brother, mm-hmm. and how that really directly led to you taking a stand and saying, I'm putting an end to this.
Yeah. When I was 16 years old, my brother was 19, and he was incarcerated inside the LA County jails, which is where he was diagnosed with schizoaffective disorder. And a sheriff deputy, after instigating a fight with my brother, who was in the middle of a manic episode, hit a panic button and brought out about 4 to 5 deputies, who then beat my brother up so badly he ended up with a concussion. And what the next thing he remembers is waking up in a pool of his own blood and being handcuffed to his bedpost. He then was starved and up to 2 weeks, and he was they turned off the water in his cell, and he was forced to drink from the toilet. I say that's torture. Torture is something that's premeditated. It's consistently done. And what was happening inside our county jails was torturing people who were inside their jails, especially people who suffer from mental illness.
Well, thank you for sharing that story, Patrisse. And thank you so much for your continued commitment to getting justice here and bringing to the light some of these things that are happening in the shadows. This is LA Talk Live, streaming to you from this is LA Progressive Live, streaming to you from latalklive.com. We're going to be taking a break, but when we return, we'll be talking to Patrisse Cullors, who is the co-founders of Black Lives Matter, about the Black Lives Matter movement that has lit fire across this country. We'll be back in a bit. Stick around.
Yeah, and I want to hear about that trip to Palestine.
Yes.
We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
Women now make up 37% of the workforce, changing their role forever.
Harvard Medical School has now opened its doors to new female applicants.
The first woman is now in space.
The majority of last year's doctorate degrees were earned by women.
We've come so far.
But our news is changing for the worse. More women die from heart disease and stroke than men, even though it can be prevented. Make a change at GoRedForWomen.org today. Brought to you by the Ad Council and the American Heart Association's Go Red for Women.
It started out...
Hi, this is Marcia Witeka, inviting you to join me every Monday at 1 p.m. for Born to Talk, where conversation plus connections equal community. Starting Monday, April the 13th, be sure to tune in to Born to Talk with Marcia Witeka, Mondays at 1 p.m. Pacific, exclusively on LATalkLive.com. You can also listen live at iTunes Radio R&B, TuneIn Radio, Radio Flag, Live 365, or AHA Radio. This is reality radio, handcrafted for your listening and viewing pleasure. We are LA Talk Live, and we are born to talk.
Say that you're watching me. Welcome back to LA Progressive Live, streaming to you from LA Talk Live. I'm Dick Price, your junior host, and senior host is Sharon Kyle. And our guest is our fairly long-term friend, Patrisse Cullors.
So before we broke, we were talking about Patrisse's work to bring some justice and fairness and humanity to the L.A. County Sheriff's Department. And now we're talking about an organization that you co-founded, hashtag Black Lives Matter. So I'm just going to just give you the floor and tell us about Black Lives Matter, and also tell us about the keynote address that you gave at, what is it?
ACLU Lobby Day.
At ACLU Lobby Day in Sacramento.
Yes, Black Lives Matter. So grateful that it's taken fire across the country and across the world, and all the places I've traveled, people are using the hashtag and the framework to really develop a new vision for black people in their countries. And it's powerful, and it's exactly what myself, Alicia, and Opal were hoping that this hashtag and this project were able to do. In 2013, George Zimmerman was acquitted of Trayvon Martin's murder.
Right.
And we were devastated. I think the country was devastated, at least those of us who were against the murder. And black folks in particular were just doing a lot of grieving over social media, especially younger black folks. And Alicia Garza, who coined the word Black Lives Matter, wrote a love letter to black people, and essentially saying to other black folks who were super demoralized, and also sort of being nasty about the verdict, saying things like, well, don't you know that this is how this country treats us? Why are we expecting anything different? Right. And she pushed back and said, actually, I'm going to be surprised every single time that they kill us. I'm not going to allow them to numb me. And our lives matter. Black lives matter. And if you see that thread, I hashtagged Black Lives Matter. And I just sort of went on this like very emotional rampage on Facebook, tagging all my black friends, telling them your life matters, Black Lives Matter, hashtagging it. And then within a few hours, I sent her another Facebook message, and this is all public, saying, I think we should do something with this hashtag. I think we should create a national project. And within the couple hours, she said, okay, I'm with it. And we launched the project the next day. And I was on the radio show, because that weekend, lots of us were out protesting. And so I was on the radio show on Flip the Script Radio with Riku Matsuda, talking about the development of Black Lives Matter. So that happened in 2013. And we used the hashtag in a lot of different ways. Opal Tometi came on pretty much 3 days later, the third co-founder, who created all the infrastructure. She created our Facebook, our Twitter platform, our Tumblr platform. We started asking black folks to share their stories. What does it mean for Black Lives to Matter? Show us the protests that you're at. And a good friend of mine, I started to really see the resonance of Black Lives Matter when a good friend of mine in Delaware, a journalist had taken a picture of her, and she had the sign, Black Lives Matter. Uh-huh. And it was like amazing to see this in Delaware.
Yeah.
And then... after that, Cece McDonald, who was a black trans woman who was defending herself from a white racist man who was probably going to kill her. Mm-hmm. She actually ended up in prison for manslaughter. We used the hashtag around her case, Black Lives Matter. And then Renisha McBride was murdered. And then we used the hashtag around Renisha McBride's murder because we really wanted to have a broader conversation around all black lives. This was an important conversation to talk about how black people, all black people are facing structural oppression. And then Mike Brown's murdered.
Right.
And that's when the hashtag and the project goes viral. And Mike Brown's murdered. Myself, Darna Moore, who's from New York and who's the editor of the Feminist Wire, one of the co-editors, we actually organized a ride to Ferguson, where we brought over 500 black people from across the country, including Toronto, Canada, to drive into St. Louis and Ferguson on a freedom ride, on a modern-day freedom ride. And we spent 3 days there working in solidarity with the community and bringing resources to the community. And then after that, we hear the non-indictments happen. At some point, Eric Garner is also murdered, and the non-indictment of that officer. And we see the need for a different conversation in this country around anti-black racism.
Right. So. In several ways, this has been marvelous. The social media aspect, mm-hmm. the capturing the nation's attention. So the question is, how does that translate into a long-term movement that's going to have dramatic impact to actually change things, not just bring attention to it, not just unite the black community?
Yes. I think that the big thing we wanted to do is, how do you capture our imagination first? Because there's so much... just the subjugation of black people is just depressing. It's flat out depressing. And the impact that it has, not just on on black people, but like on our ability to imagine something new and different. I think that's what Black Lives Matter is and has been able to do. And then we have 23 chapters across the country, including in Ghana and Toronto. We are developing and coordinating a strategic plan around what we see the long-term vision for the black community. And we think it's important that we support grassroots organizations that are currently on the ground, like LA CAN, Los Angeles Community Action Network, organizations like Mind, Dignity and Power Now, organizations in New York and the middle of the country, to really have a cohesive, create a cohesive effort around how we build not just Black Lives Matter, but other orgs and black organizations that are trying to move an agenda for black people.
So you started out by saying that it was the acquittal of George Zimmerman that was the impetus for this. And I just kind of wanted to inject this, that since George Zimmerman walked away, he's had no less than a half a dozen interactions with police.
Yes.
And I guess, you know, as a black person, I was devastated. I hate to say as a black person I was devastated, because I always hope that any human, you don't have to be black,
yes,
to care that a teenager was gunned down for no good reason. But anyway, I was devastated. But what keeps coming to mind for me as I see this is the silence of a majority of the white community in the United States.
Yes.
And so for those who are concerned that this hashtag Black Lives Matter, mm-hmm. there are those that try to counter it with,
yes,
All Lives Matter.
Yes.
Why don't you talk a little bit, talk to that.
I have 2 points on that, and then I can elaborate. Myself, Alicia, and Opal always say, if Black Lives Matter, then we would never have to use the hashtag Black Lives Matter. And if Black Lives Matter, we will fight. If all lives matter, then we will fight like hell for black lives at this moment. And those are important. I think that's an important introduction, because especially after this last shooting that was on camera of Walter Scott,
right,
the ways in which that officer so casually shot him was just such a portal to the way that white racism plays out in the black community. And the ways in which he was super clear, I mean, it was like as if he'd done it so many times before, walked over to Walter after he murdered him, and planted evidence, and then proceeded to handcuff him.
Right. And it wasn't even clear that he was dead at the point that he handcuffed him.
Exactly.
He was expiring.
Exactly. And watched him die.
Yes. And no empathy whatsoever.
And I think I think if that doesn't turn your stomach and make you want to interrogate the ways in which anti-black racism plays out in this country, then those folks have serious problems. And I think there might not be the people we're trying to organize. We're trying to organize the people who are disgusted and disturbed, but also the people who are a little bit on the fence, right? That are trying to deal with, well, do we really live in a country that really hates black people? We're trying to work with the people who are saying, you know, I really want to figure out how I can be of support. And we have a lot of folks, I would say ally groups in particular, that are trying to figure out how to be of service in this moment.
Our friend Peter Larman was concerned on that point that the faith community, both black and white, has been slow to get on board, not just Black Lives Matter, but police violence and jail violence. Do you have any comments on why they're so slow?
Well, I don't know why the faith community is so slow, because it seems like an easy thing to get on board with. I mean, it's human life, and the faith community is supposed to be upholding human life. I think that these topics are difficult for people to deal with. I think if you look at St. Louis during Easter weekend, they did an amazing action called Black Church, called hashtag Black Church, where they went to the black church, and it was very respectful. They held an action outside of multiple black churches, and they held signs, Jesus was a revolutionary. And if Jesus was alive during this time, I bet you he'd be shutting down a freeway.
Right.
And some churches, black churches, were grateful for the message and heard it, and some black churches were very upset. And I think there is this notion that if for some black churches, if we just pray, that things will change. And a lot of the St. Louis community, the folks who put it on down there, were Millennial Activists United. They were saying, well, we need prayer and we need action.
That's right.
And that's the way change happens. And that's what King said. I mean, and to be honest, King was a little bit marginal during his time as well.
Right.
It wasn't like the faith community then was coming out in droves. King really pushed the faith community to come out.
Yes, that's a good point. And I was thinking that when you asked the question, when you look back historically at the role of the church, not just the black church, the role of the faith community, there was a very strong faith community in the United States during the 200 years that black people were enslaved in chains. Right. There was lots of churches.
Right.
So this business of the church not taking a strong position against these kinds of injustices definitely has a precedence. So you talked about this last terrible killing, and I don't even know if it was the last, this of Walter Scott, because what happened with Walter Scott, and then just 2 days before Walter Scott,
yes,
there was Eric Harris.
Yes.
And Eric Harris, Dick, you kind of alluded to Eric Harris. He's a young man who was gunned down by the Tulsa PD, a well-heeled person who contributed handsomely to the Tulsa PD, had an opportunity to be deputized, a 73-year-old man, mm-hmm, and he was riding in the car at the time that Eric Harris was apprehended. This person got out of the car, attempted to tase Eric Harris, but instead used his gun and shot him. And I saw the video and heard the man say, oh no, I shot him with the gun.
Yeah.
And Eric Harris says, I can't breathe, or I'm having trouble breathing. And the police are literally sitting on top of him with their knees on his head,
cursing.
And cursing, said, I don't give a fuck that you can't breathe.
Mm-hmm.
I probably shouldn't have said that word. Sorry.
Mm-hmm.
Oh boy.
But you know, back to Sharon's point about, you know, where's the white community in this? You know, and indeed, where's the Jim McDonald's? I mean, where are the law enforcement people saying this is clearly out of bounds? The mayor of New York, Bill de Blasio, attempted to make a pretty strong statement around the Eric Garner murder, but then got pressure from his police union and backed it up.
Yes.
You know, the black population in the United States is 10, 12, 15%. By itself, it's not going to change things. And really, the problem isn't with them. I mean, the racism isn't with them. You know, white America has to somehow come about and do an about face. And you know, and there's also the point that institutionalized racism goes hand in glove with economic poverty, with economic issues, yes, that need to be addressed as well. Do you want to comment on that?
Yes. I mean, I think that we have so many, I think there's a few things I want to say about that. One, we have to have a more candid conversation about police unions and the role they play in creating this dynamic in which officers and deputies feel like they can kill with impunity, they can abuse with impunity. The Peace Officer Bill of Rights is a huge conversation that I've been having since the creation of Dignity and Power Now, which was because as we started to really fight for civilian oversight, we started to realize, oh, this is going to have limitations, not because the county wants it to necessarily, but because there are laws that are in place that allow for police officers to do things that civilians can't.
Right.
And I think part of the work I think that we need to do is start to figure out how do we deal with police unions. And in fact, the Peace Officer Bill of Rights is very new. It's only was created in the late 70s, and I say that's a reaction to the civil rights movement.
Right.
And I think we are in an important moment in history where we can galvanize off of the momentum and the exposure to start to look at what are the strategic ways that we can, and my argument is, amend the Peace Officer Bill of Rights so that peace officers don't have the protections the way that has allowed them to essentially kill and maim and torture and have corrupt departments with no legal recourse.
So a few months ago, I did a story about a young man who was at some friend's house. He was outside taking a leak because the bathroom in the house was busy. And while he was outside, Riverside County sheriffs shot him 7 times from behind. And there's video. But anyway, as I was doing that story, what I discovered, and I had no knowledge of this, is that we do not have a national database where police departments across the country have an obligation to report when they use their firearms, whether they're fatal or not. We don't have a way to make a case against what's happening in the United States because we don't even have the information. Mm-hmm. So do you guys address that? And
so the state of California, part of why I was at ACLU Lobby Day was lobbying around 3 different bills. I don't know all their bill numbers, but we can figure that out and put it up on the site. But one of the bills is specifically around this conversation around the use of force. And right now, law enforcement agencies across the country are it's not mandatory for them to submit their use of force statistics to the FBI. It's voluntary.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So the state of California is actually trying to pass a bill that would make it mandatory. And I think, you know, oftentimes what California does, whether it's great or not, the rest of the country follows.
Right.
So I really want to push folks to really look at that bill. We went and lobbied the assembly members around this bill. It's an assembly bill. So I think that's one thing. But I do think this conversation around data is so important. It's such an if we don't have the information, then folks are allowed to do things over and over again, which is why so many groups fight for civilian oversight. Because what happens is the law enforcement is able to have all their information in secret.
Right.
And there is no exposure. There is no light shining on the things that they do. So information is important. I think the other thing that's important to talk about is I'm actually going to be starting working with Ella Baker Center on a national project to develop data from the community. So we know when things happen in our community. We're around to witness it. We see it. So I think there also should be community data, not just data that comes from law enforcement or the FBI. So we're starting to work with different groups across the country to develop a national database that can hopefully inform policy that comes from the community side as well.
Right. So LA Progressive has a database. It's called unarmedblackmen.net. And I started a spreadsheet a long time ago and took that spreadsheet and converted it into a database. And it's an interactive database so people can just go up to it and add names to it.
That's great.
It asks for the name, the date of the incident, and a link to the story. So
that's really great. We should definitely put that in our toolkit.
Yeah.
So I mentioned briefly that you joined a contingent that went to Palestine. Can you tell us about that as well?
Well, that was special. There was 14 of us from the Black Lives Matter movement. It was a Dream Defender delegation. Dream Defenders are a group down in Florida led by Phil Agnew, who were also developed after the wake of the George Zimmerman acquittal. Actually, they were developed after the murder of Trayvon Martin. They reached out to me and asked me to be a part of a 14-person delegation, folks from Ferguson, myself, folks from Florida, and folks from, I think that's it. I think that was the team. And we went to Palestine for 10 days, and we met with Palestinian activists and artists and children and family, and we visited the West Bank, and we went to Ramallah, and we went to Hebron. And it was one of the most painful delegations I've ever been on. Nothing would have prepared me for the level of violence and militarization that exists in Palestine. Nothing would have prepared me for the level of racism and just the way in which you have to be silent often. I mean, to even utter the word Palestine in the state of Israel is, no one does it. And so the point of the trip was to show solidarity, and the point of the trip was to talk to another group of people who are under occupation and to build a link around the Black Lives Matter work here in the States and also the occupation of Palestinian people in the state of Israel.
So what was your connection like with the Palestinians? Mm-hmm. Were they aware of Black Lives Matter?
Yes, very much so.
And did they ask for pointers? Did you share with each other tactics?
Yeah, we did a lot
strategies.
We did a lot of exchanging, but also a lot of listening. It was intense to hear how much the project of Israel is. Well, one, I already knew the project of Israel was supported by the U.S. government, but also the tactics in which the U.S. government uses upon Black people in particular, to see some of that happening as well in Palestine. There's like a crazy statistic that almost every Palestinian person has been in prison because of the level of just oppression that exists in the community. And also, we got to also see amazing things like the hip-hop artists that exist in a lot of the refugee camps and the work that they're doing with the children. I mean, children who are growing up as refugees. We got to hear young women hip-hop artists, and that was really powerful. So I think our trip was a necessary and important trip to broaden our understanding. I think what happens in this country a lot is that the government, especially the U.S. government, tries to disconnect Black folks in America with a larger global movement.
Right.
And it's a lie. We're a part of a global movement that's against lots of things, like the war, against global oppression. And so that was a powerful piece of that trip.
So you've mentioned some things that are coming up for you and your organizations. Do you want to recap something that's coming up that people could jump into?
Yes. So Dignity and Power Now heads to the working group every Friday. So we're going to the working group this Friday, April 17th, at the County Board of Supervisors building. There's also three town halls happening this week around civilian oversight, and that's being led by the County Board of Supervisors. There's a town hall in the Antelope Valley. There's going to be a town hall in Sylmar, and there's going to be a town hall in La Puente. Tonight is at the town hall in Sylmar. Wednesday is in La Puente, and Thursday is in the Antelope Valley. So if you're in any of those places, please head out. And you can once again look at Dignity and Power Now's Facebook page to see where each of those places are going to be.
So that's Dignity and Power Now Facebook page. And do you know by chance if the LA County Sheriff's Department, might they have some information about these town halls
on their
website?
Yeah, I don't know if they have it on their website, but I know that Sheriff McDonald went to the first town hall, which was in Supervisor Mark Reilly Thomas's district.
Okay.
So I'm going to put in a shameless plug for us. Mm-hmm. Common Cause is giving us an award at an event Wednesday night called Democracy Rocks. Information about it's up on LA Progressive. So we're being recognized along with Daryl Steinberg, the former Senate pro tem in California, and a chief judge, Ronald M. George. and our friend Marcy Winograd is going to introduce us.
Right, and it's going to be at the Skirball, which means I need to get a new dress, Dick.
I got to find a tie without spots on it. So this is delightful. So how do you see yourselves evolving over the next years in this kind of activism? And what do you want to do with the next 40 years of your life?
Well, I'm going to create this national network with alongside the Ella Baker Center to really bring victims and survivors of state violence together to have a broader platform. I think, especially given my experience and what happened with my mom and the work I've done here in Los Angeles, I think more victims and survivors need a voice around what's happened to them and tools to what do you do next when your loved one has been killed by the government, essentially. Well, how do you relate to that and how do you respond to it? And then I eventually want to go get my master's in divinity because, you know, I'm a religious studies major, and right. I want to open up a church.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Very cool. I would not have expected that answer.
Yeah, I think the movement needs more spiritual centers that are focused on both spirituality and the work that we're trying to do. And so I'm a very spiritual person, and I would like to, I'm an ordained minister, so I'd like to open up a church.
Oh.
So in the movement, do you see a lot of engagement from the legal community, attorneys?
Yes, attorneys. There are many attorneys that have showed up on the front lines, both in St. Louis and across the country. Purvi Shah is one of those attorneys who's in Florida, who's done an amazing job at trying to bring together lawyers that are for social justice and doing this work. So the legal team, we have a lawyer here, Nana, in Los Angeles, who's been the backbone of Black Lives Matter Los Angeles.
Right, so Nana is with the National Lawyers Guild, mm-hmm. and the National Lawyers Guild is one of the founding organizations of People's College of Law.edu. and the reason I'm pushing this is because while it's extremely important that we do have activism in the streets, and it's extremely important, you know, that we travel to other nations and see how this oppression happens really globally, we have to have tools.
Yes.
And this is a nation of laws.
Yes.
And we want to affect policy and legislation. And really one of the key ways of doing that is to become knowledgeable about our laws.
Yeah, and I know you were pretty excited that you got a rise out of at least a couple Black Lives Matter members who might be interested in checking out PCL. I mean, it's for people who are thrown into activism, it's a way to leverage your skills so you can really make a difference.
That's right. Well, Patrisse, it was really exciting having you here with us today. And Dick and I are really, we're very proud of you.
Thank you.
We've known you for several years, and we've watched this whole thing unfolding. We'd like to encourage other people. Please go to Dignity and Power Now on Facebook to find out about the town halls and to find out about opportunities for engagement.
Yeah, thanks so much, Patrisse.
Thank
this was
you.
Wonderful. Yeah.
So, we're going to be rounding up this edition of LA Progressive Live. We've still got a couple of minutes left.
Well, so I can say that we know that next week's guest is Victor Naro with the UCLA Labor Center, and we're going to be talking about the efforts. So we talked about it today. I mean, institutionalized racism and it's hand in glove with poverty. Well, Victor Naro and the colleagues at Raise LA are looking at ways to pull people out of poverty.
Yeah. So I'd like to end on a positive note. Even though it is very depressing when you think about the number of people who have fatal encounters with police officers, particularly unarmed people, it's depressing. However, I think Patrisse has shown us that a person can make a big difference, and many people can make a big difference. And we're seeing changes. I mean, when we met you, Sheriff Lee Baca was still in office. We had an election where one of the sheriffs was part of a gang, Tanaka. So we can make a difference. And we just want to encourage our listening audience to please register to vote, become civically engaged, join actions, do something. Let's make this country a fair and safe place for everybody.
Amen.
So this is LA Progressive Live, streaming to you from LATalkLive.com. I'm your host, Sharon Kyle, in studio with my husband, Dick Price, and our guest this week, who is Patrisse Cullors. As usual, we have our fantastic engineer here, Richard Carr, who in a few weeks is going to be a guest on the show. We'd like to remind you that we're here every Monday at 3 o'clock. We're so happy that you joined us, and we hope that you'll join us next week, same time, same place. So long for now.
Good show, hon. Thank you.
How can you receive if you're not a believer? Is it blue like the sky? And does it really reach that high? What color is love? Is it near? Is it far? Is it distant like a star? What color is love? Does it glow like an ember? And do you remember? Does it live in the past? And a heart cannot live if a heart isn't giving. When it's over, does it show? Does it leave an afterglow? And I really want to know what color.
Thank you for tuning in to LA Talk Live, reality radio handcrafted for your listening pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we're more than just talk. Stay tuned.